Bibles this morning, please, to John's Gospel, chapter 5. The Gospel of John, please. And we're in chapter 5. The Gospel of John, and we're in chapter 5 this morning. This chapter begins with the Lord Jesus healing the man by the pool of Bethesda. And it was a mighty miracle. But the problem was, the miracle was performed on the Sabbath. And because the miracle was performed on the Sabbath, that rattled the Jews' cage. The Jews objected. And the Jews sought to persecute the Lord Jesus because he performed this miracle on the Sabbath. You know, people are telling us today, unless we see miracles, we won't be convinced. I can tell you now, miracles won't convince anybody. It didn't convince the people in the Lord's day. In fact, when the Lord Jesus wonderfully and mightily and powerfully healed the man of Gadara, when the whole city came out to see him, they asked the Lord Jesus to depart from their coast. They didn't want him, even though he'd done these great miracles. The people didn't want him, you know. And the Jews, they sought to kill the Lord Jesus and to slay him and to persecute him because he healed this man on the Sabbath day. And the Lord Jesus didn't back away from them either. And the Lord Jesus addressed these Jews. And we're going to break into the words of the Lord Jesus down at verse number 30. In John 5 and verse 30, and the Lord Jesus says this to them. He says, I can of mine own self do nothing. And then he says this, as I hear, I judge. And my judgment is just, because I seek not mine own will, but the will of the Father which hath sent me. And if I bear witness of myself, my witness is not true. There is another that beareth witness of me. And I know that witness which he witnesseth of me is true. Ye sent unto John, and he bare witness unto the truth. But I received not testimony from man. But these things I say that ye might be saved. He was a burning and a shining light, and ye were willing for a season to rejoice in his light. But I have greater witness than that of John. For the works which the Father hath given me to finish, the same works that I do bear witness of me, that the Father hath sent me. And the Father himself hath sent me, and borne witness of me. And ye have neither heard his voice at any time, nor seen his shape. And ye have not heard his word, and ye have not his word abiding in you, for whom he hath sent him ye believe not. And search the scriptures, for in them ye think ye have eternal life, and they are they which testify of me. And ye will not come to me, that ye might have life. And I receive not honor of men, from men, but I know you, that ye have not the love of God in you. For I am come in my Father's name, and ye receive me not. If another shall come in his own name, him ye will receive. How can ye believe which receive honor one of another, and seek not the honor that cometh from God only? Do not think that I will accuse you to the Father. There is one that accuseth you, even Moses, in whom ye trust? For had ye believed Moses, ye would have believed me, for he wrote of me. But if ye believe not his writings, how shall ye believe my words? And we know that the Lord will add his blessing to the reading of his own precious word. My text this morning is John 5, and it's verse number 30. The Lord Jesus speaks and he says, I can of mine own self do nothing. As I hear, I judge. And my judgment is just, because I seek not mine own will, but the will of the Father which hath sent me. And we know that God will bless that text this morning. On Tuesday, as I got before the Lord, in that own wee quiet place that I have, the Lord addressed my own heart. And unless the Lord addresses the pastor's heart, how can any pastor be prepared to address the hearts of his flock? But the Lord addressed my heart very, very clearly on Tuesday morning. And this is the question my heart pondered as it came from the Lord. How well do I understand the true nature of prayer? Not preaching, but prayer. And how well do I understand this morning the whole matter of prayer? You know, child of God, this morning, as the Lord was addressing my heart, and I'm going to be honest with you, I realized on Tuesday morning how far off the mark I was when it came down to the whole matter of understanding prayer. And mind you, child of God, this morning, prayer is a very precious thing. I wonder this morning how people can cope to go through the pains and the dark times of life without prayer. And I can assure you, child of God, this morning, there's nothing more precious and there's nothing more powerful than prayer. But I believe, child of God, as I searched my own heart, and I have to search my heart just like anybody else, I feel, child of God, I feel that we at times, and I'm including myself because I got it all wrong, I believe we can have a wrong understanding of prayer altogether. Do you know what I learned on Tuesday morning? There's more to prayer than praying. I want you to get that this morning, child of God. There's more to prayer than praying. There's more to prayer than getting down on your knees and crying out to God. There's more to prayer than praying. And child of God, this is something that the Lord wants you and I to possess this morning, a fresh understanding concerning the matter of prayer. Prayer is a very precious thing. And it's a very precious jewel. And it's the most neglected jewel of God's great treasures. The jewel of prayer. When you think of Peter this morning, Peter, you remember in Acts of the Apostles in chapter number 12. You remember there he was imprisoned because Herod had killed James with the sword. And it says, and because Herod saw that that pleased the Jews, he decided to take Peter also. And the people knew the danger that Peter was in. And you'll read in Acts chapter 12, there was a prayer meeting going on because of what was happening. And you'll find in Acts of the Apostles chapter 12 that there was a house of a woman called Mary, the mother of John, whose surname was Mark, where many were gathered together and they were there praying. And as a result of that prayer meeting, Peter was wonderfully and miraculously delivered. You read Psalm chapter 3 this morning. That psalm was written during one of David's, if not David's, darkest hour. An hour when his own son Absalom was after him and for his kingdom. And David could say, I cried unto the Lord, and he heard me out of his holy temple. Prayer is very precious, child of God, and how many times you and I have proved prayer to be precious. There's something I want to encourage you to do this morning. I would encourage you this morning to take a wee piece of paper, an A4 size of paper, or a notebook. Go for a notebook. Well, go for a notebook. And I want you to do this for your own Christian life and for your own prayer living. I want you, for your own sake, to take a wee notebook, as from this morning, and write down in that notebook throughout 2017 how you have proved prayer to be most precious and how you have proved prayer to be most powerful. And I'm telling you, when you get down to the New Year's Eve, it'll surprise you how many times God has allowed you to prove just how precious prayer really is. But there's more to prayer than just praying. You see, first of all, there are three paths that we must tread in order this morning to be engaged in real prayer. And I think, child of God, this is where we get our prayer life so wrong. And I believe this is where our prayer life and how our prayer life can get cold. Because we fail to take these three paths. Three paths that takes us to real prayer. First of all, we've got the path of supplicating to God. Now, I want to call this path this morning the familiar path, because we're all familiar of supplicating to God. And you know, child of God, this morning, as Paul tells us in Philippians chapter 4 and verse 6, we're to be careful for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known unto God. And you know what God is saying? God is saying this morning, listen, I want you to come to me, and I want you to supplicate with me, and I want you to bring your cares and your problems to me. There's a great promise, child of God, on the path of supplicating to God. There's a great promise to encourage us to supplicate the throne of grace. Jeremiah 33 and 3. Call unto me, and I will answer thee, and show thee great and mighty things which thou knowest not of. You know, child of God, this morning there is every reason that you and I should supplicate the throne of grace. And mind you, this morning there's nowhere and there's nobody in the scripture who can teach us more on prayer than the Lord Jesus. Throughout the four Gospels, you'll find many, many times where the Lord Jesus was engaged in prayer. Mark 1, verse 35, as in the morning rising up a great while before day, he went out and departed into a solitary place, and there prayed. Luke 5, verse 16, it says this, and he withdrew himself into the wilderness and prayed. That path was a path this morning the Savior trod, and mind ye, he walked it constantly. The path of supplicating to God. Have we trials or temptations? Is there trouble anywhere? We should never be discouraged. Take it to the Lord in prayer. When I look at the Lord Jesus in prayer, this is what I see. If the Lord Jesus, my lovely Lord Jesus, needed and leaned and prayed, and as he leaned on prayer and as he himself prayed, how much more do I? There's an old saying, but I think we take it too lightly. Much prayer, much blessing. Little prayer, little blessing. No prayer, no blessing. The path of supplicating to God. That's the familiar path. Now, this is what I had to learn from my own quiet time. There's another path that we must tread if we're going to engage prayer effectively. It's not just, mind you, the path of supplicating to God. We need to walk the pathway of listening to God. In John 5, verse 30, the Lord Jesus says, I can of mine own self do nothing. And then he says this, as I hear. Now listen, do you see the path of supplicating to God? Now that's what I call the familiar path. We all are very familiar with that one. But here's the forsaken path concerning prayer. You know, child of God, what I had to learn this morning, I had to learn it. Prayer this morning is not just all about us crying to God. It's not all about us speaking to God. Prayer is just as much of God speaking to us. I wonder, child of God, have you understood this? Prayer this morning is not just this morning. It's not just all about you and I speaking to God. Prayer is just as much of God speaking to us. You see, that's the secret of the secret place. That place this morning where God and you meet. Do you know, child of God, this morning why we miss out so much in prayer? It's because we fail to listen. The place of prayer this morning is the place, the one place, where we can develop our intimacy with God. Many years ago, in the early years of Billy Graham's evangelistic ministry, a young farmhand went to hear Billy Graham preach. And on that night time, or that evening, God spoke to that young man, and that young man went forward and was counseled and accepted the Lord Jesus as a Savior. Every convert who went up to the front was received a package of little booklets that would help them now in their newfound faith. That young man went home that evening and went to bed, searched through the booklets and read through them just for a few moments. And the next day he got up and he did the same, and he began to learn to pray and to read his Bible. But he came to this book all about prayer. And the wee thought that was based on prayer was in Matthew 6 and 6, where the Lord Jesus says, but thou, when thou prayest, enter thy closet. And when thou hast shut thy door, pray to thy Father which is in secret, and thy Father which seeth in secret shall reward thee openly. This young man suddenly realized the necessity of having a secret place where he can pray. Every morning at 4 o'clock, he used to get up and he used to go into a wee shed or some sort of a shed where they kept bales of straw. And he used to climb up over the top of the bales, and he had a wee place where he lifted a few bales out. And he used to get down into this wee hole in the corner of the barn. Barns was the word I'm after. And he got into the corner, and he got into the corner with his Bible and a flashlight. And he would pray. And in that wee corner, in the corner of the barn, away down that wee hole, with his Bible and flashlight, this is what he learned himself. It was the wee place where I not only talked to God, it was the place where God spoke to me. And child of God, this morning, one of the great problems and the great reasons as to why we miss so much out in prayer is because we fail to listen in prayer. See, the Lord Jesus says in verse 30, I can of mine own self do nothing. The Lord Jesus, it doesn't mean that the Lord Jesus hadn't the power to do it. No. The Lord Jesus was making it known that he couldn't act under his own authority. You'll read, friends, where he spent all night in prayer. All night. And friend, this morning there are very few prayers of the Lord Jesus recorded. Why? Because I can tell you now, he did more than speak in prayer. He listened to the Father communicating with him in prayer. And I wonder, child of God, this morning, while we are in prayer, are we waiting for God to communicate to us in prayer? Because you see, there's more to prayer than praying. There's listening to God. And the Lord Jesus said, as I hear, that teaches me that when the Lord Jesus went to the mountain and he got on his knees, friend, he did more than pray. He listened. Old Alec Reed taught me many years ago, learn to pray, he said, before you preach. Because prayer is not just about interceding with God. Prayer is about God interceding with us. It's not just about engaging with God. Prayer is about God engaging with us. Wonder when was the last time, child of God, when you were in prayer, you listened. Wonder when the last time was when you were in prayer, you heard God speak to your thoughts. You see, there's more to prayer than praying. What I had to learn this morning of myself was this. Every preacher must learn to kneel before God before he stands before people. Leonard Ravenhill says, the man who has gotten God's word in the prayer closet neither seeks nor expects encouragement from men for the delivery of that word. The Spirit himself bears witness of its approval. Child of God, listen. Do you see prayer? There's more to prayer than pray. Because prayer is not only about us pouring our heart out to God. Prayer is about God pouring his heart into ours. I would call that now the forsaken path of prayer, because mind ye, very few of us are prepared to listen to God in prayer. As I hear, the Lord Jesus says in verse number 30, I judge, and listen to this bit, and my judgment is just because I seek not mine own will, but the will of the Father which has sent me. Now, here's the third path. And here is where the power of prayer is ignited. You could spend nights and weeks in prayer and it'll not do a button of good. You could spend weeks crying out to God, and it'd be no use. And child of God, there's more than supplicating to God. Aye, and there's more to prayer than listening to God in prayer. Now here's the secret concerning the power of prayer. It's obeying God in prayer. The Lord Jesus says, what I hear, I judge. What I hear in prayer, I do. What I hear in prayer, I obey, for I seek not to do mine own will, but the will of him that sent me. Listen, child of God, here's what I want to say. Here's what God wants us to see. Prayer is not just about asking God. Prayer is not just about listening to God. Prayer is all about surrendering to God. Do you remember the Lord Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane? He got down and prayed three times and says, Lord, not my will, but thine be done. You see, that's the secret of secrets as far as prayer is concerned. It's not just supplicating to God in prayer. Not at all. It's not just about listening to God in prayer. Not at all. It's about surrendering to God in prayer. Wonder this morning, is there someone here? Then you're wrestling in prayer, and it seems to you that God isn't listening. Let me tell you the problem that I have found. The problem is, it's not that God isn't listening. The problem is we're not listening. That's where it lies. You see, oftentimes in prayer, we're too often prepared for God to listen, but we're not prepared to listen. That's the problem. Wee book in the Old Testament of Habakkuk. In Habakkuk chapter 1, you'll find the prophet in prayer before God, and he's crying out in desperation. He says, O God, how long shall I cry unto thee, and thou wilt not hear? He couldn't understand why a pagan nation was coming as a punishment instrument for the land of Israel. He couldn't understand it, and he cried out to God. And what you'll find in Habakkuk chapter 1 is him crying and complaining to God, are you not listening, God? But then in chapter 2, he stops the crying and he stops the complaining, and he learns in chapter 2 to listen. That was the wisest choice Habakkuk did. In Habakkuk chapter 2, verse 1, I will set me upon the watchtower, and I will hear what God has to say to me. I'll tell you, when Habakkuk stopped crying and started listening, he could hear God. You know what it says? Do you know what Habakkuk said? I hear thy speech and I'm afraid. And you know, child of God, there is more to prayer than praying. The Lord Jesus, he not only supplicated the Father, in prayer, he listened to the Father. And in prayer, he obeyed the Father. Maybe this is where we've got prayer all wrong this morning. Because you see, this surrendering all to God in prayer, I call that the forgotten path. Because so many of God's people today have forgotten that we've got to obey God. And obeying God in prayer as we listen to Him is where prayer counts. And it's where prayer makes the devil tremble. May we learn this morning. May we begin to understand this morning the true nature of real prayer. May we learn and understand what the whole matter is.